Hey everybody, welcome to the second episode of VHS Bandits. This week we talk about the right connections. Let's pop in the tape. I feel good all the way till the party's done. I can't stop partying until I see the sun. Are we party, man?
And now, our feature presentation.
Hey everybody, welcome to the second episode of VHS Bandits. I am the KevBot, and with me as always...
Topher Hansen.
And...
Dane Train.
Alright. Hey guys, how's it going?
Good.
Good, good.
Hey guys. So good after watching The Right Connections.
We literally just finished watching that, and we could not wait to record
tell you
this
all
podcast
about
and talk about it.
How did we pick this? How did we come across this movie?
So, were you with me when I bought this?
No.
Maybe I was just. This movie is kind of creepy.
Did you buy this in Maine?
No. I bought this at Savers. I know that. I got this at Savers for 99 cents.
Wait, maybe you were with me and I just don't remember it.
I don't know, but I watched it before and neither of you guys said you watched it with me. So it makes me think I watched this movie alone by myself one time, or I watched it with our mutual friend John, but I don't know.
Yeah, this was my very first viewing of this feature film.
Yeah.
I didn't even know that this thing existed until I saw the tape on your coffee table one day.
Yeah, so I mean, yeah. I didn't know it existed. So I'm going through Savers and much like... the previous tape, the cover, I mean, this is what makes anyone buy a VHS tape, is the cover.
Yeah.
Which is, if you don't know this movie, which you probably don't, it stars MC Hammer and Melissa Joan Hart from Clarissa Explains It All.
But there's a catch. Melissa Joan Hart is like barely in this movie.
Right.
She shows up and she's in some of
she's
it.
She's in three scenes in this movie.
Yeah.
Maybe four. Maybe four. But so that's why I bought this. I was like, a movie starring MC Hammer and Melissa Joan Hart of Clarissa Explains It All, one of my favorite shows growing up. It's got to be amazing. And the box is MC Hammer and Melissa Joan Hart are in like a star on like MS Paint, and there's a little drop shadow, looks kind of good, and there's three other kids who are, as far as I can tell, Melissa Joan Hart's actual real life siblings, because all of
their
last names are Hart.
Yeah.
And it's by Heartbreak Productions, which I can only assume is her family's production company.
Has nothing to do with the Hart Foundation, the wrestlers, Bret Hart,
right,
and Owen Hart.
If you were getting confused.
Yeah.
If you thought that this was a WWE film, no. Mm. It is not.
Nope. Has nothing to do with that. This film will not put you into a submission hold until you tap out. You'll enjoy every moment. Enjoy every moment.
Also on the cover, there's these three kids that are her siblings, and they're in like 90s hip-hop gear. And so the tagline is, he's got the moves and they've got the grooves, which neither of them have really any talent in this movie. Dane, why don't you read us the back of the box and give the audience some idea what this is about?
I can't lie. Like, the one thing that sells it to me is the wicked 90s, like...
The font.
It's all like... It's all wacky, and it's like
Wingdings font.
Yeah,
it's like Wingdings mixed with like the Wingdings mixed with like the cutouts.
Yeah,
like magazine cutouts.
The ransom font.
Yeah,
it reminds me a lot of House Party. The font on House Party. So, all right. So, like, the back of this thing has MC Hammer flying around in a big orange star, and there's. You know it's a great movie when, you know, like on the back of a box art, there's like the little screen shots from the movie.
Yep.
They're two screenshots from the exact same scene. So that's how you know the movie's awesome.
Little did we know until we watched the movie.
Yeah, they're both from the same like hip-hop contest scene. But anywho, Yes, let me read the box. So, all right, here we go.
Hold on. Just looking at the back of the box, you think the whole movie, because of those two pictures and MC Hammer, you know, being like, hey, guys.
Takes
place in, like, a club or something. No, just the one scene.
You think there would be a copious amount of hip-hop?
There's very little hip-hop.
There's
a loose definition of hip-hop in this movie.
There's as much hip-hop in this movie as there is Melissa Joan Hart.
that's a very good way to put it.
Okay. Anywho, so, all right. This is the box's description. So if you rented this at Hollywood Video, this is what would suck you into it. So, MC Hammer and Melissa Joan Hart from TV's Sabrina the Teenage Witch star in this music-filled comedy about a retired music star who gets a chance to make a comeback when he helps a group of kids facing financial problems. With their father gone, their mother out of work, and a large tax bill due, the kids decide to enter a hip-hop contest to win the money. A chance encounter with Kicking Back Flash, MC Hammer, and the sympathetic taxi driver, Melissa Joan Hart, give them the right connections they need to get their act together. They only have 6 days to do it, but it will be 6 days none of them will ever forget.
Wow, that, don't you just want to watch it?
That outlines the entire movie.
Yeah, you don't need to watch the movie anymore. That is the movie.
That touched upon every major...
Actually,
almost every major
they don't,
plot.
Yeah, but
they
don't get into the actual hip-hop contest until like an hour into the movie.
Yeah.
Right?
Yeah.
I literally, when we were watching this, I remember telling you guys like, oh, I forgot this movie's about a hip-hop contest.
Yeah.
Because they don't do anything about it.
There's a lot of like generic hip hop R&B music like in the background. Like when
Kevin MacLeod's work.
Yeah, right? when you open up, when the movie starts and opens up the first scene, it's the kids making breakfast to like this really positive hip hop music that's like super generic 90s, but like, do my best, gonna be real cool, do good in school kind of thing.
Yeah, it's like the soundtrack is...
It's like Don't Copy That Floppy.
Right, yeah. It's like music...
What's that, Don't Copy That Floppy?
You have to look it up on YouTube.
It's a PSA from the early 90s about anti-piracy of floppy disks for like floppy games like Doom or Number Munchers or Word Munchers.
You could say that almost translates
Super Mario
to a movie like this.
Yeah. And it's about basically an MC Hammer guy who's like, yo, man, don't copy that floppy.
It's directly rated. But yeah, the music is much like early 90s PSA music or like, you know, when a positive thinking touring group would come to the school and be like, don't drink and go to the prom.
It's all like, yeah, we can do it. Yeah, we can do it. We believe in ourselves.
Yeah, it's just like they're singing about abstinence and shit like that and then come to your school or whatever. That's very much what the music is like in this movie at best.
To reference South Park, the exact kind of performance that would make you not want to do what they are rapping about.
Right.
Yeah.
I do not want to do my best in school. I think I will drink and go to the prom.
If my best at school is going to result in me being a terrible hip-hop musician touring around at middle schools, then I'm out.
You guys are nowhere close to as good as Rockapella.
Right. So it opens up and these kids are making breakfast in their house, right?
Yeah,
their mom's birthday.
Their mom's birthday. They're making a freaking mess
everywhere. Burning toast. They're boiling coffee. Like they're basically like endangering themselves and the whole neighborhood by almost like destroying their kitchen and just making a mess so they can give their mom breakfast in bed.
Yeah.
She eats it though.
She does.
She ate the bacon.
That's true.
Yeah, that's it.
The pig's
butt. Threw away the rest. Yeah, she's like, I love pig's butts.
So there's
that was her compliment.
There's four kids. There's the going from oldest to youngest. I don't know any of their names because they so very rarely
said them. I think one starts
them.
With a J.
There's the oldest daughter. There's the son. The middle the middle daughter, and then a young daughter.
Yeah, same thing.
Who's like the cute, I can never be mad at you. You're so freaking cute.
Yeah, I think the little baby daughter. So maybe age wise, the littlest kid is maybe like 2 or 3 years old. Like she can barely speak, or she's just starting to speak, or something like that. She can walk. 40 years old? I don't know. I would say she's probably like six.
Yeah, like six.
Oh my God, really?
Yeah.
Well, because she goes to school.
Well, so. I have nephews that are like 1 and 4. And
oh, okay. So she can talk.
They can barely function, let alone
right.
They're
off in their own la-la land, you know?
All right, so this kid, maybe I'm not the best one to do this. This kid's 6 or whatever. And then the next girl, she's maybe 10? Is that fair?
She's probably like 10. And then the boy is probably like 12. 13. And then the oldest girl is probably like
15, 16.
14, 15, and because she doesn't have her driver's license yet, which is how they come across Melissa Joan Hart, because they can't drive a car.
Yeah. Right. You're right.
They can't drive a car.
So she's below driving age.
So they bring her breakfast in bed, and she's like, oh, blah, blah, blah. Thanks, guys. I can't believe it's my birthday. You got me a mug with all your faces on it. A mug with your mugs on it.
Yeah.
She doesn't actually say that. I've just thrown it in.
And then cut to MC Hammer, and he's talking. He's at his mansion.
A.K.A. Kicking Back.
Oh, yeah.
We find out right from the bat that the mother is having some job issues.
When she's late for work, and you find out like the boy, he doesn't like to brush his teeth, and he loves hip hop and stuff, dude.
Oh yeah,
all
he's
the
got
Coolio,
five Coolio
yeah.
posters.
Coolio
in his bedroom.
Posters posted all over his wall.
It's really hardcore.
The oldest girl does homework the entire movie. She says she's doing homework,
but she's just doodling.
Probably the whole
time.
That's true. Anytime you see the page that she's actually working at, it's probably like, I don't want to be in this fucking movie.
Right. The very youngest, likes to spend all day in her PJs, and the middle child is the stereotypical middle child, getting bad grades on her report card, always got...
She's the Bart Simpson of the trooper.
Kind
of,
yeah. She's always got an attitude. She's sassy.
Yeah.
Because she's like the middle daughter.
So when do we find out that she doesn't have any? She's got money problems.
She says like she's late for work and she's worried about work and stuff because they're doing cutbacks or something.
Oh, whatever.
Yeah. So it's then we cut to
Then we go to MC Hammer
kicking back
Flash for all intents
but
and purposes.
He also has like his real name, which you don't find out until like way late in the game. His name
nobody calls anybody
Kendrick,
by their name.
Kendrick something.
I didn't catch on to that one.
Oh. My mind just immediately goes to Kendrick Lamar, who's not
associated
in any way
with
related with MC Hammer. In all of my notes, I just refer to him as Hammer. That's it.
Yeah, me too. MC Hammer. And so he's talking to his manager, yeah?
I imagine so. Yeah, and he's walking through his empty mansion and... You're like, where is all his stuff? His manager comes in. He's like, oh, where's your couch? And he's like, oh, that sweet leather gray one with the recliner? Oh, yeah. It was repossessed.
Yeah, he's like,
had to pay
my
electric
couch,
bill.
Sold my forks and knives. So basically, MC Hammer's living in an empty house, except he still has like a suit of armor and like 10 platinum
gold records on his wall.
But he has to sell his couch.
And
he's a suit of armor.
He's begging his manager for a gig, and he's like, listen, something just opened up because some dude bit his tongue off and can't perform.
Right.
And he's like, nah, I don't know. Oh, wait, I need money. Yeah, I'll do it.
And they repossess his Bentley in the driveway.
Oh, yeah.
And that's when he agrees to do the tongue bit off gig.
Yeah.
Yeah,
and I like the fact that, which I didn't find out until later, but his manager is played by Hollywood Montrose from Mannequin, which is
awesome.
That's great.
No living mannequins in this movie, though, unfortunately.
No, not a single one.
And then so
could have helped, but no, the movie was fine without mannequins.
Oh, by the way, I don't know if we mentioned or we may have alluded to, but this movie was made in 1997, so it reeks of 90s fashion and music and things
right,
like that.
Right, but it seems like it's because like in 1997, like This seems more like 1992.
It does.
Than 1997. Yeah. There's a big difference.
Yeah.
This is still very 1992. It was filmed in Vancouver, Canada, so maybe they're behind by 5 years.
Their 1997 is our 1992. Right.
Yeah. They haven't quite discovered Fred Durst yet.
Right, you know? Exactly. Yeah. Yeah,
I would say he's a little
except
more 1999.
Except for the little kids' outfits were very Fred Durst.
That's true, yeah. Well, like, all the kids wear clothes that are like 5X.
Yeah.
It's crazy.
Hey, that was the style.
Yeah.
Everybody's I had
elephant pants.
Yeah, I wore pants that were five times as big as my body.
What do we have? Rock-A-Wear and
JNCO jeans.
JNCO.
So then the kids are like, hey, we never go to school except when it's plot appropriate.
No, you're jumping ahead a little.
No.
Because he takes the gig. He says, all right.
Yeah.
Okay. Let's see his wardrobe.
Holy shit. Yeah, you're right.
So we're going through, like, he's got nothing in his house except his gold records and his suit of armor. And he goes into his closet and it's filled with clothing.
Yeah.
Like weirdo clothing. It's like a Halloween store.
And he tries on at least 20 different outfits.
It's a 5-minute clothing change montage of MC Hammer in like sailor outfits, in like a jockey outfit,
in like a cat mask.
Yeah,
he's in the house by himself, and he's like, I like this. Ooh, yeah, this is funky fresh. Yeah,
yeah, and he talks to himself the entire movie. Yeah. He's definitely schizophrenic.
It's awesome.
Because he has all of these strange personalities in all his different Halloween clothings, and he doesn't stop talking to himself.
Even when he's at the clothing stores.
Like, yeah, so he
doesn't... He's always just talking to himself.
Yeah, so I guess he doesn't have the appropriate outfit for this shitty dive bar where people don't have any tongues that he needs to perform at. So he goes to the mall. Meanwhile, the kids go to the mall.
Because they're going to put on a surprise party for their mom.
No, we don't even fucking know that. We just know that they're buying something, right?
Yeah, they're buying stuff for the surprise party.
I
thought they were buying another gift.
Yeah.
Did they even buy anything at the mall?
I don't know, but they bought all the supplies. They did touch upon it.
Did I even watch this movie?
Apparently not.
Maybe not in a few years.
You know, you guys wrote down a million notes. I didn't write down anything.
They really did touch upon it.
All right, whatever.
So
they're both at the mall. That's all that matters.
Yeah, they are both at the mall. So we're following the kids. And first off, it turns out that the boy...
He's getting bullied. He's got bully problems.
He hides from these three kids who look exactly the same as him.
Yep.
Yeah, they all got like that.
They have no reason to bully him.
Yeah, they all.
Except that he doesn't have a dad. We forgot about that.
Oh, yeah.
So, like, their dad left him. The first line in the movie
is
like,
too bad dad's not here.
Or something like that. Yeah. Some, like, really depressing
throwaway
line.
That could have been the exact line.
Yeah, I'm pretty sure it was.
Too bad dad's not here. Yeah, because he left.
Yeah.
It's like,
exactly.
Well, yeah, that's he's not there.
Because he doesn't love us.
Does he want to run away
with
a hooker?
I'm assuming that they don't all have the same dad. Let's be realistic here. That mom's a slut.
No, because they're all Hart kids, so they all look the same. So I imagine one dad, but he was probably just like,
yeah, where'd you get that idea from?
Three kids?
Well, this is...
Okay, four kids? No, I'm out of here. I can't do this. Mom does not have a good job, and MC Hammer does not have a career. I cannot be in this household.
Right.
Oh, funny enough, too, just about MC Hammer's career, the back of the box is kind of misleading because it says that he's a retired music star, but he's not retired. He's just washed up.
He's very, very...
He's just not in the game.
No, he's not. He's very far from the game. He wants to be in the game, but
also,
he's just warming the bench.
I don't think we've mentioned this movie takes place in Detroit.
Oh, right.
And it is the most beautiful depiction of Detroit I have ever seen.
Suburbia Detroit.
This is the, like...
That stuff probably takes place like right outside Detroit. Michigan has some nice areas.
No.
But not Detroit. They
mentioned Detroit like
nothing,
specifically.
Nothing against anyone who's listening from Detroit. But we're just saying, given what we've seen, this is not Detroit. This is a really nice version of Detroit.
it's very whitewashed depiction of Detroit, and everything is like clean and nice. Like, I don't know. I've seen some like Google images of Detroit, and that's not what I pictured.
I've seen hardcore porn.
Yeah, I've seen hardcore porn.
Detroit.
Yeah, the clientele of hardcore porn is the furthest thing of the cast of this movie. Let's just put it that way.
Yeah.
All right, so we go back to the mall.
Yeah.
Because that's where everyone is.
This kid's getting bullied. Everyone.
This kid's getting bullied. And
they're like, you don't have a dad. Fuck you.
And they push him up against the wall. And then
that's exactly what they
say. That's pretty much what they say, yeah?
Yeah, pretty much. They're like, haha, you don't have a dad.
Yeah.
He's like, what are you doing in our mall?
We have strong households, and you have a broken home.
With these bullies, they're always like, what are you doing here? We said you couldn't be here. Like, clearly they have told him exactly where he can and cannot go, and that he never stays in the areas where it's okay for him to be.
Right? Yeah. And so then his sisters come to save him. They see that he's being bullied, and his sisters come up and
the middle sister,
yeah,
says, "Oh, I cut myself," and then sprays fake blood all over the wall.
Like a Kill Bill amount of fake blood is gushing out of this girl's arm and splashing onto the wall, and the kids are like, and, ugh.
The bullies are. I don't want to say they're not phased by this, but they're just like, ugh.
Well,
that's gross.
It's just like bad direction. They're just like gross.
They should be screaming in horror at the blood pouring out of this.
They should be
small
like, oh my
child.
God, do you need help?
Yeah. But they're just like, I think there's a first aid kit over here. Come on, brother. Let us go.
Nobody else in the mall seems to
notice
this happening.
Nobody gives a shit about this little girl's, like, artery exploding
and they
onto
just
the
left the blood just dripping down the wall.
They didn't even bother to clean
it.
It's
the most
up.
Metal mall you've ever been to.
It is Detroit, so it's probably not the only pillar
I'm
covered
sure
in blood.
It's the only one with fake blood
in this universe. It probably is, but
so
in the real world,
in splattering fake blood all over the wall, they lose the smallest child. And where does she end up after
not by death of like blood loss, right?
She just wanders off. Yeah. So the guys, they look everywhere for her for whatever reason, and it kind of keeps cutting back, like the three kids trying to find the littlest sibling
or whatever,
and it keeps going back also to MC Hammer in the shop,
he's in
and he's
the
like
clothing store he's, looking to he's, buy his outfit that he didn't have in his like massive wardrobe.
Clearly his millions of articles of clothing are not enough, so he has to go find a sweet jacket,
which looks like what it looks like a bus station bathroom.
This clothing store it looks like it's some Subway bathroom.
Yeah, it's like a Subway bathroom. Like
gross.
The walls are all gray.
Yeah, nothing in there.
There's like no inventory.
It looks like three racks of clothing and just kind of scattered it about a little
bit. It looks
like
a dollar store that is going out of business.
Yeah.
And there's two articles of clothing that MC Hammer is trying to pick up.
And it's two jackets. One is this nice bumblebee looking jacket,
it's pretty fresh.
I thought it was pretty cool.
It's
like
pretty,
a yellow,
pretty sweet,
a yellow like track jacket.
Yeah, it might have been. What was that jacket company?
It was Body
Starter.
Glove.
Body Glove.
Nope, it wasn't that. Like everyone had them in the 90s, and they had like sports teams on them.
It looked like Puma MLB? Or something, right?
No.
I don't know.
Regardless.
Listen, if you guys know of it, just let us know.
Yeah, send us an email.
Yeah.
So Kevin can buy a jacket on eBay that looks like MC
Hammer. I don't
want to
say starting line because that's not it. But anyway, they had like every sports team jackets, and they were like these big, huge, puffy jackets, and most kids in elementary and middle school had them. So MC Hammer's looking at this bumblebee-looking one, and then he sees this
leather jacket.
This leather jacket.
Black leather jacket.
I'm going to try this jacket on. He goes into a fitting room.
One of the bathroom stalls slash
one of the bathroom
rooms.
Stalls. Yeah. And he's trying it on, and he's like, oh, man, this looks really good. Oh, how much is it? $700? I don't have $700. How much is this other bumblebee jacket? $40? Like
$69.95.
He's like, specific. Oh, I'll just switch the prices because they totally won't know. How does this store that has nothing in it
on the two article of clothes
have
that they have
a $70 jacket and a $700 jacket?
It's on sale, man.
On sale.
So then
must have been
as he's switching the
going
tags, the littlest girl just slides her head right under. Like, he could be naked changing his pants, and this little girl's head comes under the stall and she's like, hey, what are you doing, little man?
She's just laying on the floor, half her body in there.
Yeah.
And he's like, what the hell? Where'd this little girl come from?
And the whole
fucking family just slides under under the
hey,
the
what
stall.
You doing underneath this changing room? Oh, let's all take a look.
Yeah, let's
know?
All just sexually harass this random person who is just trying to try on clothes. But then the little girl's like, he was switching the tags. And then they like get in this moral debate about him switching the tags. And he's like, I wasn't switching the tags. You don't. I'm just.
I was comparing prices.
Yeah,
comparing prices. That's it. That's a believable story.
That's
comparing
the ticket.
Prices.
And then like the son with all the Coolio posters is like, hey, you're Chicken Flapjack Flash Black Man, right? And then, or whatever,
Kicking Back Flash.
Come on, guys. You're Kicking Back Flash. And then
AKA
he's like,
Kendrick.
And then he's like,
AKA MC Hammer.
And then he's like, yeah, that's me. Get the fuck out of here.
I know your one hit song. I'm going to rap it right here.
And what's the song?
Wave
Party
hands.
Here. Party there. Everybody's party there and here. And that's his one hit. That is legit the exact hit. I mean, I'm not exaggerating.
No, I wrote it down here. Let me check.
You wrote
notes.
Down the lyrics to the song.
I did. It was really easy.
Well, I mean, let's think of MC Hammer's actual career. Here we are 30 years later. I mean, Can't Touch This is the three words that anybody remembers him by. So it's
not
too far off.
You're
party
right.
Here. And he is washed up. So
party here.
He's kind of
party
there.
There. Everybody, hands in the air.
Wow.
Party
okay.
Here.
Wow.
Party there. Everybody, hands in the air. Which you could also rob someone with those lyrics.
It's probably
party
how
here.
He got
party
the gold
record. Hey, so. You, hands in the air.
That's true. It's the party's a diversion. So then what? He goes and fucking buys the jackets and the kids.
And the
ask for an autograph.
The boy wants the autograph.
And so he just gives him an autograph with a random piece of paper in his pocket.
Which we'll find out what it is later on. Well, he also tells the kids about his
like charity work. Yeah, so he's like, why haven't you rapped in so long? And then MC Hammer's like, well, I've just been... He doesn't want to admit that he's washed up nobody. He's just like, I've been doing charity work or whatever.
No, I'm doing charity work. Like, tonight, I'm singing at a club for tongueless people.
Oh, yeah, yeah.
Yeah, that's what I'm doing.
And so... The kids...
They just accept it. They're just like, okay, cool. So the boy asks for an autograph, and the autograph, although we see it later on, it is his Kicking Back Flash, but it looks like it says MC Hammer. Like, he was going to do MC Hammer, and he goes, oh, wait, what was my character's name again? Kicking Back KB Flash.
He just has a very creative way of spelling Kicking Back Flash, and it starts with an M and C and a... Ends with a hammer.
So everyone's just content with that. He buys the jacket. They get the autograph and they leave and they go do the surprise birthday party.
Oh, yeah.
And as the mom's walking in, apparently she got laid off due to cutbacks.
Yeah, she's
she doesn't
talking
have
to
seniority.
Herself again. She's just spitting out exposition. She's like, oh, no, I got caught. I got laid off.
How do I tell my kids?
Right.
Hey, kids, you know that job I had? Oh, I mean, you know that job? Yeah,
I don't
whatever.
Have it anymore.
I don't have it.
And then
anymore.
She opens the door. Surprise! There is a million people in her house. I've never seen so many people at a surprise party that you never see again. You don't know anybody's names. She doesn't talk to a goddamn person there.
She only talks to the kids, and they immediately bring over the cake. Yep. And then the oldest daughter's like, "Hey, this is my boyfriend Eric. We're gonna go and make out."
Yeah, she's
sorry.
Like,
I'm sorry. I'll stay if you want, but.
But
no,
I'm
not going to.
She
yeah,
says,
exactly.
Here's your cake. Here's my dickhead boyfriend that you don't like because you're shaking your head at him. And by the way, I'm leaving. Goodbye. And
yeah,
then
you
she
can,
just leaves.
You can tell right away he's kind of a scumbag because he's like, hey, my parents are going to go on vacation. Yeah,
his
awesome.
Parents are never home. They're always on vacation.
It's apparent in this movie that the parental units are almost never home.
Never.
Except for MC Hammer, but that's because...
He doesn't have kids.
Exactly. Exactly. If you have kids in this movie...
Right. Or anybody
if you have kids in this movie, you're just away 90% of the time.
Yeah.
Yep. So then she's like, kids, I got laid off at work. And... So this is after the party. They're like cleaning up or something.
I think it's like in the morning or something. I don't remember exactly, but she's looking at like all these bills, and then then in the morning she's like, "Oh, kids, by the way, I lost my job, and we can only afford to live in this house for 4 months before I have to find a new job." And by the way, weirdest thing, we live in this house month to month paying rent. No lease. No, like, we own the house.
Sounds like a scuzzy landlord.
Yeah, it's really weird.
Yeah.
Detroit.
This was like a Craigslist, like, rental agreement or something.
Maybe they had to move away from the dad, and that's why they had to get into someplace so quickly, and that's why they don't have a good deal. Mm. Wow. Maybe that's why it's only month to month.
That's scary. I would like to see the dad come in and, like, fuck up this family. Like, just not that I want to see the family get murdered, but I would like to see that movie. It would be much more interesting if there was a vengeful, murderous dad.
Are you
on
saying
the
this
loose.
Movie was not interesting? Because
it was very interesting.
I was entertained through the whole picture.
I was enthralled. But if there was a murderous person on a rampage, that would just add to it. And if he had a hip hop solo.
So one of the kids, I don't remember exactly which one it was. I think it might have been the oldest. Opened some of the mom's mail.
It was the middle kid.
It was the middle kid.
The oldest sassy girl middle does kid. Not give a fuck about anybody. No, she is a stone cold bitch.
She's all about doodling.
Yeah, she just wants to fucking doodle and not help her family at all.
Yeah, the middle kid opens the mom's mail, which is a federal offense.
Yeah. But can we just rewind for a second? Because so they are talking to, like, the mom is, like, talking to the kids, and they're like, oh, I got laid up or whatever. And I just want to give you a sense of, like, the jokes in this movie, like the humor in this movie that they think are jokes or what they try to be funny. So the mom is like, I just got laid off at work and we're going to have to downsize the home and da 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 da. And then, like, the son's just like, bleh, and just lets out, like, a huge belch, and that's supposed to be funny.
It's supposed to break the tension.
It's supposed to break, and they're just like, yeah. Oh, you, just burping all the time. He's like, bleh, and then just end on, like, a freeze frame smile. Like, that's the type of humor that they're going for, but none of the jokes really hit.
Mm. Yeah, whenever the kids get into arguments, they kind of keep going back and forth over the same thing.
Yeah,
there's
like
one
this
scene where someone's like, oh, well, I bet you do this. And someone,
I
and
do
the
do
other
this.
One's like, well, duh. And then
they
it
just
goes back and forth
for like
duh,
5 minutes.
Duh, duh. And it's not even the comedy rules of three. Come on, guys.
Yeah, it's like comedy rules.
That would make 18. Sense. It's like the comedy rules of multiples of. I got nothing. That's dumb.
We don't need to get into long division of comedy rules. We'll be here all night. So she opens the mail and she finds out that their father owes the IRS $5,000 in back taxes or some shit, and the mother is responsible for paying it for some reason. What? Why? We never know why. It's just like, you have
her
to pay your
device.
Yeah, it's just like, we don't want to make the mom look bad and irresponsible. So this father that doesn't exist and we don't have to allude to is a bad person. He owes $5,000 in the IRS and is putting it on the mom for some reason, which is just completely illogical. So the mom has to pay this father's $5,000 IRS bill. And meanwhile, I have to say, they are talking in a closet.
Oh yeah, they're talking about they hid in the closet from the mom, who does not know she owes $5,000 because they want to hide it from her for whatever reason.
Get her into more trouble. Get her arrested.
And the kids are just like, oh, well, we got to do something.
Yeah, why are we in a closet? Like, because mom owes $5,000. Why else would we be in a closet?
Also, I opened her mail, and I don't want to go to jail.
But then the mom catches them.
But she still doesn't know she owes
$5,000. They don't tell the mom that she owes
$5,000. They just play
so
it off as a,
serious repercussions.
We're just hiding in the closet. Here's your jacket.
Yeah.
Have a good day. At school. She goes back to school. That doesn't
matter.
Oh,
yeah, the mom wants to... So
that doesn't really matter.
No,
that much.
It kind of does, because she's a very irresponsible mother. Because she gets laid off from her job, and she's like, instead of getting another job, I'm going to go back to school. I have 4 kids to feed, but we're not going to have any income. I'm going to go back to school.
Because they can survive for 4 months. 4 months is all she needs to get her the rest of her degree.
One month. That's a thin line to walk.
She's only 12 credits away. That's 4 classes. As long as she gets B's, I think. I don't know. I'm so far removed from college, I don't remember. But she could do it. I believe her. But how do you drop out like one semester before you get a degree?
Because you have four kids. Well, that's how.
Yeah, okay. Well, maybe the dad ran away and she's like, oh, well, I guess I can't finish this master's degree. It's weird, though. So, I got to point this out. She can get another job, but not as good of a job. And if she gets this degree, she can get a really good job. And I think that really does, you know, point out that this is the 90s, because that shit don't fly now.
No. She would just collect unemployment and, like, get, you know, live off the dole with, like, four kids.
Maybe their father was avoiding tax evasion and, like, went to Mexico.
On $5,000?
Possibly.
That's
actually
nothing.
At this point.
For tax evasion purposes.
In this location,
I mean,
probably more likely to Canada.
There you go.
Because it was filmed in Vancouver?
Oh, yeah. It was filmed in Vancouver.
It was filmed in Detroit.
Detroit. It's right
the
there.
Great
Detroit,
North.
Detroit, yeah. Canada.
Yeah.
So the kids say, hey, MC Hammer has money.
Right.
Let's just go ask him, because he likes charity, and we're a charity.
Yeah,
we're going to mooch off this dude.
Let's just ask MC Hammer for $5,000. He's rich. You know, he's got nothing better to do than to hand out $5,000 to every four white kids that he sees. So then they go to his show at this tongue-bit-off place, which is in shitland Detroit.
They have to get there first. And Dane Train, who is their taxi driver?
Who else but Clarissa from Clarissa Explains It All.
Yeah, which this is like half an hour into the movie, maybe. I don't even know. It's a good at least 20 minutes in the movie.
Something
and
like that.
The top billing star has not shown up yet. And this is the scene she shows up, and she is a like 20-year-old girl taxi driver in Detroit with a fake New York accent. Or some, I don't know.
It shows up halfway through her scenes.
Yeah, halfway through her scene she develops this accent.
Yeah.
So she takes them to, she starts taking them to this really seedy bar.
Yep.
And she goes, hey, wait a sec. You guys you're all kids. How are you going to pay for this? They go, no, we're not going to pay for it. And she goes, all right, get out. No, wait a sec. I'll get in trouble if I just leave four kids in the middle of
downtown Detroit.
I'm taking you home.
And the kids are like, wait, we need to go to this MC Hammer show. We'll pay you. My sister will cook 10 meals for you. And like, assuming that like Melissa Joan Hart is not capable of finding like food on her own. But Melissa Joan Hart's just like, oh, really? That's a good deal. That sounds great. 10 meals from these strangers.
Hot meals. I don't have to live in my taxi cab for like a week.
Yeah, how struggling is everyone in this movie that Melissa Joan Hart can't find 10 meals, which
they never cook her a single meal.
Detroit, Canada is going under.
Seriously.
Is this RoboCop Detroit? It's like almost RoboCop Detroit. When did RoboCop take place?
It's getting pretty bad. Rough times there.
Yeah.
And so she's like, that sounds like a good deal. For this one taxi ride, by the way.
Round trip
to Shitville Club.
That's 5 meals per
way. Yeah. So then she accepts this offer of 10 hot meals because she really likes lasagna. And they go to the shitty club that
MC Hammer is
performing at, and he's just up on stage, like holding the mic in front of his mouth, because obviously the words don't match up with. They're like, we don't have a song yet. Just fucking dance around and hold the mic up against your mouth, so we don't have to sync it in post.
You miss something though.
What?
How do the kids get in?
Oh man!
How do four underage kids get into this seedy bar
at like that, 2 in the morning?
Yeah, like 2 in the morning. That is filled with these just badass-looking people.
Yeah.
Oh, well, there's a guy who's working on the air conditioning unit, and they say that he's their dad, which they don't have a dad. But the bouncer's like, that seems plausible. He's right in the back. Mm-hmm. So they go in, and the boy like immediately goes up to the bar and is like, I'll have a beer and some nachos and some peanuts and some beer. And the bartender's just like, get the hell out of here. And he's like, all right, cool. But the little girl, the cute little girl who can't do no wrong, she goes up to these two badass-looking dudes who are eating chicken wings. And for some reason, they're just doing close-ups of these two guys eating chicken wings. And she goes, you guys going to share? And they just push the They push the chicken wings towards her. She starts eating.
Yeah, she just befriends these.
Wouldn't you guys?
Hell yeah.
Absolutely. They look friendly as anything.
Yeah.
Clearly if I see someone that small in a bar, then I'm going to give them chicken wings.
Yeah, I'm feeding children chicken wings in bars all the time. I mean,
that was a big stack of chicken wings. I don't think those guys could have finished them themselves.
Probably not. I mean, they were pretty large guys.
It was,
but
to be fair, it was 25-cent wing night. Okay,
that's
so
true.
There's plenty of wings to go around, and
that little girl's got a pretty solid stomach if she's at that age and eating hot wings.
Yeah,
man, I can't handle that.
Oh yeah, she's probably gonna need to go to the hospital, get her stomach pumped. But MC Hammer's like, nobody's paying attention to him.
I love his goofy like MC Hammer dancing where he's just like shrugs around his shoulders and yeah. stuff and like moves
the dancing in this
sideways,
movie is amazing.
Moves vertically.
He's almost like two legit
it's yeah like, it's, hammer
yeah
that stuff.
It is very like
parachute.
If you can imagine dancing in two dimensions, that what it is, that's what it is.
Yeah.
That is two-dimensional dancing. Like he can't go front or back, he can just go side to side. So he
finishes up a set and the kids go approach him in the back.
And he's talking to himself again. And he's like, fuck this. Nobody gives a fuck about me. I'm going to pack up my shit and...
I'm going to pack up my $600 jacket in this oversized duffel bag.
Yeah.
And the kids come in and they're like, hey, we're poor now because my mom doesn't have a job. And hey, you're a performer. Why don't you just give us $5,000? That's all they need is $5,000, and then, like, everything's fine. Just $5,000. Seems very obtainable, I guess, in a sense. So, and he's like, no, I'm not an ATM. You see an ATM on this body? No.
He's like, there's no money coming out of my butt. Blah, blah, blah. And he makes this poopy butt money motion. and he's basically like, fuck you, kids. I hate you. And so the kids are kind of, like, discouraged, and then... like, this scene doesn't need to be in here. And they go and, like, do a montage of these kids trying to make the money on their own.
Because they find that the autograph that MC Hammer's...
That's after, though.
No, this is in the cab on the ride home.
Really?
Because they're like, oh, man, he was kind of a jerk. Oh, man, what did he... movie. What kind of paper... what is this paper that he signed his autograph? Oh, his Bentley's been repossessed.
Yes.
Yeah, so oh, maybe he's not as rich as we thought. So then we get to a montage of
but
the kids.
But this doesn't need to be here. If that scene came before this montage, it really doesn't need to be here. So these kids try and make money themselves. So the boy is mowing people's lawns, and the lawnmower is going crazy.
It proves that MC Hammer doesn't have any money. So they go, ah, shit. Well, we gotta do it ourselves. So the oldest, yeah, the boy,
okay,
mows everyone's lawns. The oldest daughter babysits 9 babies.
Yeah, and then the middle daughter is a dog walker, and she walks the same 3 dogs in the same camera angle. Like, I think we're supposed to assume that time is passing, but it's the same camera angle, same 3 dogs, same outfit, same everything, and they're just going all over the place being kooky crazy.
Who makes the most money?
The little kid.
Well, how does she do it?
Selling lemonade.
I don't know how she didn't have 5 grand, because, I mean, like, there's a shot where the line's, like, at down the street.
Yeah, she was cleaning up $2 lemonade. A glass for this, like, shot glass of lemonade.
You got to imagine there's
the
setup
stuff
cost.
Too.
Overhead.
Making the sign. Yeah, overhead. Yeah.
Lemons
know,
ain't cheap
supplies.
In Detroit. They're out of season.
Oh, well,
especially in Detroit.
Yeah, so then they make, like, $50 or some...
they make 100 and something.
Yeah.
So the middle girl, while she's like trying to sleep one night, hears a radio contest. And if you hear, they're going to play a song at midnight. And the next day, if you hear that song, you have to be the 9th caller and you win $4,200.
Yeah, the exact difference between what they made and what they need. And then so they go to school the next day, and they all bring portable radios and Walkmans with them, and they listen to it in class.
To the radio,
yeah.
Because they got to be the 9th caller.
They got to be the 9th caller to
get
this
$4,200.
So the oldest daughter, who does not give a fuck about her mom or these kids or anything, she is – this makes no sense, but she's signing up for French club or something, and then her like 30-year-old boyfriend is like, French club, that's for dweebs. And he just erases her name from the French club class. And
she's like, well, I take French. And
he's like, not like, anymore.
No, you're my girlfriend. You don't take French.
No, no, my girlfriend speaks French.
We don't speak.
This is British Columbia, not that fucking Montreal bullshit. Detroit.
And then,
so then he snags her Walkman and changes the radio station. Goes, this is the one that rocks.
Yeah, this channel rocks. But not whatever random station. I have no idea. It could be commercials on right now, but this rocks. And so he erases her from French Club, changes the radio station so she can't listen to it. And his parents are out of town again.
Yeah, parents are out of town. This dude is like such a douche.
Yeah.
Such a huge D-bag.
He is a 30-year-old high school junior.
Who we can't pinpoint. He looks like so many different people you would have recognized from other movies, but he's not.
Who did I say I thought he was?
Ooh. I don't.
I thought he was the DJ Tanner's boyfriend
From Full House.
He looks exactly like him.
He looks very similar. I thought he was the jock guy from Can't Hardly Wait, who always beat up the nerdy kid. Mm-mm. Who went out with I can't remember her name, but it doesn't matter.
No, not Melissa.
Not Melissa Joan Hart. Who? Hart. Melissa Joan Hart was Jennifer in Can't Love Hardly Wait. Yeah, he went out, so, but not no, wasn't
yeah, no, yeah, it wasn't. Yeah,
no, it's all connected. All connected. But no, he's not anyone you would recognize him. But he's not actually.
He's got one of those faces.
He does. He looks like every other white guy.
That's racist. And so then.
Not if it's true.
So
they miss out on the brother and the middle kid.
They go to the payphones, the little kids.
Turns out when they do get through, they're the 89th caller.
By the way, while they're at school, ninth. Who the fuck is watching the little girl? Where is she?
She's in school. She's like kindergarten. Yeah, or like preschool.
Like daycare or something.
No.
Well, it shows them like they all get when they later on in the movie. We're going to jump ahead a little, not to spoil much.
This to me, because I don't think they do that.
They get into the car with Hammer. They get into his beat up old red car.
Yeah.
And the little girl's with him. It's the boy, the middle child, and the little girl. Him. Yeah.
And so that doesn't mean she goes to school. She's with MC Hammer.
No. All three get into the car, and later on when there's a scene where they don't get a ride home from Hammer, and they all come in, and she has a little lunchbox and a little backpack.
All right, this is very suspicious.
Pay attention to the details.
Sure, I believe you.
So they miss out on being the ninth caller.
Yeah, so then they get pissed at the older daughter, like, you changed the channel, fuck you. We're never going to get mom in school. And
by the way, if you missed out on the $100. Here's a chance to win $5,000 at a hip hop contest.
Yeah,
the third annual hip hop contest. That's Detroit hip hop contest.
That's exactly what it's called. It is called the third annual hip hop contest. Okay, now that we've got that out of the way, just let that sink in for a minute. Then they're like, oh man, MC Hammer is a hip hop mogul. So they realize that he has – his Bentley was repossessed. So their plan is to basically blackmail MC Hammer into making them hip-hop stars so that they can win this contest. And Dane just farted, so that's why everyone's laughing.
I just farted the premise of the movie, but also to Dane farting.
Into the mic next time.
So they go to him and he's like, I can't help you guys. He's still trying to get money. And then he has a meeting with a record executive and his manager.
I'm so confused by this point. I don't know.
Chris, were you there? Did you watch this?
I don't think so.
Did you fall asleep?
Were you doing something else? I've seen this movie twice and I have no idea what's happening.
We just watched it.
I know.
We finished it less than an hour ago.
Let's talk about what we do remember. How about that?
Yeah, I mean, I don't. He gets blackmailed by these children. They just show up at his house. I have no idea how they get his address.
They're like, hey, we're a bunch of little kids. we know about your Bentley being taken by the repo man. We'll get it back for you if you turn us into hip-hop stars for the third annual hip-hop contest.
Right, exactly.
And the little girl sweet talks him by just being like, do you have any peanut butter in the house? And he's like, all right, guys, I'm going to help you out.
And he's like, okay, I got peanut butter. Like, I'll help these kids.
All the while, the oldest is just like, I don't want to fucking be here.
Yeah.
She's
got a terrible attitude.
She's just got homework to do. Doodles to make. Come on, guys.
Yeah.
I got some straight up doodling.
She's got to listen to Eric, her boyfriend, or her D-bag, talk about how his parents aren't home again.
So then...
He's
at the meeting with his...
He's at a fancy restaurant with his...
Fancy Detroit five-star
with
restaurant.
With his producer and a record executive. Yeah. And all the kids come in, and they... come up with this plan to have Melissa Joan Hart go to...
So she basically test drives the Bentley at
Yeah, she
like
goes
the repo
to a car dealership that has the Bentley for whatever reason.
They clearly have the information of where it went to. I guess it was
on the slip. Of
course,
you can find it. It's probably on the... Yeah, it's on the slip.
They did a VIN search. I don't know.
So she takes it for a spin, and they go by the...
The restaurant.
The restaurant. And
they
like,
wave
hey,
at... They're like, here's your Bentley.
The kids
We're
like, hey...
holding it hostage from you.
Hey, we've got your Bentley, so you help us.
Yeah.
Which is weird, because you'd figure...
He'd just be like,
fuck you kids, give me the Bentley! If he thinks they have the Bentley... They could just sell it for $5,000 or more.
Yeah.
Or more.
I didn't even think it's a Bentley.
I don't know Blue Book values, but I imagine in 1997, a nice Bentley.
Convertible, nonetheless.
Remember, they never had the Bentley.
Right. I know, but like.
But I'm just saying,
in
MC Hammer's mind.
They
you know,
have it.
Oh.
Yeah,
MC
like they.
MC Hammer's dumb.
Yeah.
Yeah.
He's not.
I'm sorry. MC Hammer is probably an intelligent guy. I mean, Kicking Back Flash
is pretty dumb.
He starts very dumb in this movie, but he gets smarter because
and
he's
his
like
heart gets bigger.
What's that?
His heart gets bigger.
Yeah, it gets three times as big, which might also kill him.
Which could be the drugs.
It
could be the drugs.
There's no drugs in this movie.
Well, I don't know about that.
Got to point out, third annual hip hop contest. If you listen to our last podcast. You would probably see Speedboat there.
Yeah.
That seems like
the
that seems like the place
he missed.
The place that he would be. That's where his troops of dancing teens would be at.
That's right. Yeah, definitely.
Oh, and so, at this point, we have not seen the mom at all.
We've seen her like twice. She's
left
in
these kids
slightly less than Melissa Joan Hart, and we've only seen Melissa Joan Hart for a total of
twice.
Minutes. We've seen it, yeah, for like a total of maybe 5 minutes.
Oh, yeah, because she waves to him in the Bentley.
Right,
I don't know
right,
why she's
exactly.
doing she's So she's doing them another favor, but she hasn't gotten her 10 meals or anything.
It's clearly the youngest daughter just being like,
yeah, she's just
super cute.
Nobody, these kids are so
peanut
manipulative
butter.
And evil that they just make strangers do favors for them without repaying them at all.
See, that's
wow,
why
I never thought of that.
That's
yeah,
why over
they
the
are
movie,
terrible people.
That's why over the movie, MC Hammer gets smarter. The kids get more evil,
and
they're always a problem in this movie. They've always got an attitude or something's wrong, except for obviously the little one because she's the cute comic relief.
Yeah,
and MC Hammer, he becomes a better and better person, and it's pretty much by the opposite effect of these kids. He's probably like in his head being like,
"I don't
want to
be like
these kids. These kids are really shitty. I don't want to be like
step
this."
Step up my nice game. So anyway, he helps out. He helps out these kids because he thinks that they have their Bentley. So he's trying to like form a hip hop group out of these three kids. The oldest daughter doesn't want anything to do with it because she's a fucking bitch. And then these three kids like sing.
They threaten him like, "Listen, you help us, we'll get you Bentley."
Yeah.
We'll give you your Bentley back. You don't help us, you never see your Bentley again.
Yeah, they're very, very threatening to MC Hammer.
So then he says, all right, well, yeah, I'll help you. So he's talking to his record producer while they're shooting some hoops in golf clothes almost, like nice.
It's like snakeskin.
Collared
polo
shirts.
Yeah, they're
yeah,
very,
polo
it looks
shirts.
Looks like he skinned a dolphin.
Yeah.
And pulled it over his flesh.
And his manager's like, man, if you do this, you should be a producer. He's like, "Whoa, these kids are terrible." And the producer explains.
Oh, yeah, he makes a bet with him.
He does, yeah. He's like, "Listen, if you can produce these kids, I'll give you a job as a producer. And then, you know, you'll have
you
a new
work
career.
For my record company or whatever the fuck I do."
And he's like, "Oh, I can't be a producer because those kids are terrible." And the producer explains that, "Well, when you started, you were so terrible, I threw up."
Yeah.
"I threw up in my assistant's lap."
There's a lot of throwing up in this movie. Not alluded to. Not like you don't see
not
it,
actual
which would be awesome.
Vomiting.
But like... They mentioned that they throw up a lot. Everyone is, you know, has some sort of stomach bug in this movie. So then he helps them out, and they like become friends for a while. Like my notes jump really quick, so I'm just saying
I got the detailed notes here.
So
they go over his house, and he's like, "All right, well, let me see what you got." And they start singing. And it's so stereotypically bad that it shows the outside of the house and you can hear dogs howling.
Yeah.
That's how bad they are.
But then they become friends and everything. And MC Hammer is like their like father figure now.
Yeah, the great thing about him, though, through the like most of this up until the end, he's super blunt with them. He's just like, "Yeah, you guys are terrible.
Yeah.
Yeah, you're not going to win.
Yeah.
There's no way
you're
in hell.
Shit.
Yeah.
And there's nothing I can do for you." But he helps the man because he wants his Bentley. And everyone is entirely, like, very selfish in this movie. Everyone wants to help themselves. I mean, they kind of want to help their mother, but it's more or less so they're not homeless.
The
like
The three kids want to help their mother. The oldest girl is just like, I have to watch over these
guys.
Yeah,
so she can sing very well. It's alluded to that she's a good singer.
Turns
but
out
she's just like, "Fuck you. I don't want to sing in
I'll
this
I'll never sing again.
Contest.
I don't want to sing." And you're just like,
for
okay,
no
she's
reason.
A bitch. But turns out she's got stage fright because she, I guess, was the lead in the lead of a high school version of Bye Bye Birdie. And she just got really scared and didn't do it.
And
that's why
probably,
she'll never sing again.
Yeah. And so then MC Hammer is the father figure of these kids now. He sees them way more than the mother ever did. And so he's like picking them up from school, and the kid is these bullies assault the kid, and MC Hammer just watches them as he does. And it doesn't do anything to stop the bullies at all. And the kid gets back in the car, and MC Hammer's like,
"Hey, did you just get bullied?"
He's just like, "Yeah,
hey, man,
I did.
You got beat up." He's like, "Yeah.
Yeah,
No, they're my friends." He's like, "You sure? Because you got your ass kicked there." He's like, no, they're my friends."
And then he's like, "Hey, MC Hammer, do you want to kill these kids for me? You know, you might have a machine gun, or just a regular gun would do. I don't care, as long as you kill these three children for me."
But we know he doesn't, because they probably got repossessed.
Yeah, so he sold all his guns, so he can't kill these kids.
By the way, it turns out that no one likes any of these kids. Like, in the school.
None of them have any friends.
Yeah, none of them have any friends. The guy...
The family?
Yeah.
Yeah.
None of the teachers like the middle girl because she gets bad grades. The oldest daughter only has the douchebag boyfriend Eric, and even he's like a total dick and just wants to get into her pants.
Yeah, there's no nice people in this movie. Yeah. I'm telling you, nobody is nice. Maybe the mother, but she leaves her children
like
alone
Hammer.
All the time.
He's like
the
such
nicest
an innocent
character.
Guy.
Yeah,
nice.
I like MC Hammer's
he's
character.
Nice.
He's good.
So he takes all the kids to another CD bar, not the one we already saw, but another CD bar, so they can get up on stage and get their feet on there, you know?
Yeah, so they perform a shitty song for the manager. They don't even sing. They just kind of...
It's lousy.
Yeah, it's just lousy.
That's what
mumbling.
I like this movie. They kept saying, "Yeah, we're real lousy at this."
Yeah.
Real lousy.
And so the manager is... just like, "Well, you got to polish up these kids." And then MC Hammer picks up the girl at school, the oldest daughter at school.
Yeah, he like meets her in the hallway for whatever weird reason. And he's like, "Hey, I'm here to give you a ride. Ma, ma, ma. Hey, is that your boyfriend, Eric? He seems like a tool." She's like, "You don't know me. You don't know my boyfriend." You can't give me. You're not my dad. He's like, well, yeah, because your dad left. No, that's not actual dialogue. But he's like, listen, your boyfriend, he's gonna want some things, and you know, he's being like, he's
trying to like give her a pet talk and like be like, this guy's bad news. So then they get in the car. He's like, why do you have an umbrella? Because it's raining out. Because it's these are like supposed to be two separate days, but you could tell that it was shot on the same day, and like. Halfway through it started raining out, so that they needed to be, it's like one of those things like, oh man, we have to tell the audience that it's raining out because there is too much time has elapsed and they can't know that it's the same shot. And then she like storms out of the car that MC Hammer picks her up in, and she's mad at him for some reason because
for trying to be like, hey listen, your boyfriend seems like a wicked tool.
Yeah,
that's it. And he's just like, yeah, no, you don't have to explain anymore. That's exactly it. And she's like, well, that's not cool. He's my boyfriend. I'm out of here.
Oh, and then they get in a big fight. Everyone gets in a big fight for some reason. So this is when MC Hammer like splits away from the oldest. By the way, this hip-hop contest, I don't know if we said this. There's only 6 days from start to finish. From the day they announced the hip-hop contest, there is 6 days until the hip-hop contest. And this all happens within that time.
Yeah.
I feel like two weeks have already passed.
It seems like, yeah, and we're nowhere near the big day.
Yeah, there's no, like, relevant concept of time in this, like, other world, Detroit.
But this day, when the oldest girl leaves the car, they don't have practice because she left.
Yeah.
And you see all the other kids come home and be like, oh, Hammer didn't give us a ride. What's going on? He's like, the oldest daughter explains to them that, oh, well, he's not who he seems. He's not.
He's too nice.
He wants to help out and blah, blah, blah. So I told him we're not doing it anymore. And the sassy middle kid is like, well, you don't do anything to help. So why do you care? And apparently that changes her like overnight. Changes her feelings towards the whole thing. Because the next day, she's like, all right, I'll sing. I'll do this. Let's do it, guys.
So, but MC Hammer, like, there's some scenes where the kids aren't together with MC Hammer or something. I don't know. But he, like, MC Hammer is like, fuck these kids. I don't want to help them out either if they're going to treat me like a piece of shit. But then he's, like, sitting on his, like, steps in his empty mansion, and he's, like, getting really sad and emotional. And he sits on a peanut butter and jelly sandwich, and he's like, oh, this peanut butter and jelly sandwich reminds me of that little girl.
Proving that little girl, she solves all the problems.
Yeah, she's the only thing keeping these people together.
She should have been the only one going up.
She's my favorite part of the movie,
on
by the
way. Not MC Hammer?
No, her and MC
Hammer.
Oh. They're a good team.
They are a good team. It should have been just it should be the little girl just going up on stage and she just acts all cute and they'd win the $5,000.
Yeah,
no problem.
These other schmucks.
She would have been the ninth caller and they would have had that $4,200 as well.
So
if she can even use a telephone, I don't know.
This peanut butter and jelly sandwich that he pulls out of his butt crack just brings the team. You could probably hear Dane fart again. Just brings the team back together and.
Not only that. But the bullies are picking on
the boy again. Yeah, the bullies are picking on the kid again.
And
but this, so it's in gym class, I assume. And this scene is so random. It's like the kid's playing basketball with the three bullies, and there is like 50 people on the bleachers just watching them. And then MC Hammer comes out of nowhere.
And there's no teachers.
There's no teachers, no gym teacher, no supervisors. He is the
no
only
parental
adult
unit.
Just bursting into this gymnasium full of kids. And then the bullies are like, they say that in the lingo of this movie, they are fronting on him. They are fronting on him. And then MC Hammer's like, are you fronting on my boy? And then they're like, no, no, they're really scared of MC Hammer. And then he's like, good, because I'm going to fucking kill you. He threatens these children with death.
Not only does he say, I'm going to kill you, he says, if anyone messes with this kid, I'm coming after you three.
Yeah, it's very ominous.
He's going to kill these three. And there's tons of witnesses.
Yeah.
But still no teachers.
But it's Detroit, so this happens all the time. So MC Hammer is...
I'm sure not
I think
the time.
Like every other day. I think the like actual verbiage is like, are you fronting on my boy? Because I don't want to have to pile up any dead bodies. It's just this very ominous threat, yeah. And then these three kids shit their pants and don't bother the
kid. If you front on my boy, I'm going to have to just move my stack of dead bodies.
Yeah.
And I don't want to have to do that. That would be really
inconvenient. It's very time-consuming moving all these dead bodies.
By the way, did I mention that
they're getting repossessed.
I am a mortician. That is also my second job.
That's his fallback.
That's what the mom's going to school for. She doesn't want to be a real estate agent anymore. She wants to embalm dead bodies.
Yeah, so now the kids are back with MC Hammer, saves them from the bullies.
They decide that they're all going to work together.
Yeah.
And then you get a training montage where they're all singing. Oh, they're all trying on costumes.
There's another clothing montage that takes – well, this one's shorter.
This one's with the kids.
This one's with the kids. So they're trying to find outfits for the hip-hop show. But the fucking weirdest thing is that MC Hammer has a bunch of children's clothing in his home, like princess outfits. And
I thought they were in their own home.
No, they were in MC Hammer's home.
Oh, okay.
Which
yeah, that
is
makes
creepy
it,
as fuck.
That makes it creepier.
That MC Hammer has princess outfits in his home that fit 6-year-old girls.
Well, in the training montage, they're practicing in different rooms of his house, and like the final one is, it looks like they're in his bedroom, which is a little unsettling. But I mean, empty space. His whole house.
This
is
the
unsettling.
Kissing montage.
Yeah, the whole.
He's training them on how to emotionally kiss.
I guess
in front
it makes sense in a way. You need space to practice. His house is empty. Maybe what's the biggest
he's got
room that's
but
empty?
Space. His bedroom?
His bedroom. I don't know.
I guess so.
Master bedroom? You got to imagine that's pretty
but
big.
But he's got a bunch of children's outfits, and this is disturbing as fuck. But, I mean, it is what it is. Kicking back flash, just dressing up children all day and whatever.
So they're
who
feeling,
cares?
They're feeling pretty good about the performance, and the mom gets a second notice from the IRS. And that's when she breaks it to the kids that... One, she owes the IRS $5,000. And two, she doesn't like school that much anymore. She thinks she'll just get another shitty job.
Yeah.
Which would solve all the problems. But the kids are like, no. We've put way too much work into getting into this $5,000. Oh, no, I'm spilling the beans.
Yeah, instead of just getting another job, which she was going to. Like, so, it's the perfect solution. Yeah, this movie doesn't need to happen.
The mom's like, what do you mean you know about? You need exactly $5,000.
Oh, wait. By the way, we didn't even mention the mom has already met MC Hammer, right?
Oh,
so,
we totally
so
skipped
the,
over
the
that.
MC Hammer is just at the kid's house for some reason. They're training or some bullshit. And MC Hammer is like, the little girl's like, peanut butter jelly. And then he's like, I'm going to tickle you, little girl. And he tickles the little girl. And then the mom like sees through the window that MC Hammer is tickling the little girl.
And
she
jumps in. Jumps to the worst conclusion. And she's like, take whatever you want. Just don't hurt my children. Like, yeah. Wow, come on. This guy's dressed really nice.
He's dressed in dolphin skin polos.
He's tickling your daughter. Okay, maybe that's
a
little weird.
There's a strange man tickling your daughter that you've never met. So, and
but
then
the other kids aren't doing anything.
And then
so
they're like, no,
maybe
it's
okay.
This is Kicking Back Flash. He's a hip hop mogul, and he's like, hey, I guess this, why wouldn't you expect a black man to? Why wouldn't I be here to murder and kill your entire family? Something along those lines.
Yeah, basically, you can. It's okay that I.
He's like offended.
I'm okay with you jumping to the conclusion of me being in your house
to murder your family,
being a black man, and you being an all-white family, and you do not know who I am. So thus, I am here to kill and steal your stuff.
So this movie is just really like
racist.
Well, no, I mean it's trying to squash the racism problem in Vancouver and Detroit.
Still kind of goes there. But the son is like, listen, you guys would know who he is if you didn't microwave all his stuff.
Yeah.
Like, I had your CD, basically, I had your poster, but you microwaved it all.
And the son, like, walks out of there. He's, like, making you, like, thanks, mom, for being a racist. And then the kid, like, walks out. He's like, fucking white people. And he's,
that's all because you didn't want to party here and you didn't want to party there. No one's hands were in the air.
Hands in the air. So then is it time for the hip hop contest?
It's almost time for it. We show up back at school.
Yep.
And Eric, the douchebag boyfriend, is like, "Hey, my parents are out of town yet again. Maybe they're never coming home. Yeah. They're supposedly out of town for 10 days at some wedding." And the oldest
destination
is,
wedding.
The oldest daughter is like, "Oh, tonight? Well, no, I can't. I got this thing."
Yeah.
And the boyfriend's just getting the biggest blue balls because he's like, "Come on, my parents aren't home.
This
what
boyfriend
can you do that's more important than coming over and me having my way with you?"
He is a serial rapist. And he's a 35-year-old junior in high school
who
wants to rape everybody.
The weirdest thing to me is if they're out of town for 10 days,
you can just go tomorrow.
Just go tomorrow.
Just go tomorrow.
Yeah,
it's not a dilemma.
Everything would be fine. Their relationship would still be seemingly okay.
So
it's still rather unhealthy from our point of view.
Yeah.
So she's like, well, I don't know. I got to do this thing. And he's like, "Come on. You know you want to come over." And she's like, "Well, maybe."
Oh, no. Yeah. And he's like, "Come on. You can trust me. Your dad left you. I'm the only thing you have in this world."
Thus proving that everyone hates these kids.
Yeah.
A healthy relationship
is not possible. They have so many issues they need to work through.
Man, it's ridiculous. So
this guy is a manipulative rapist pig.
I guess for lack of better words, sure.
No, he's like, "Your parents hate
no,
you.
He does say
you
that.
You have nobody but me in this world." And like, he's putting the guilt trip on. He's like,
"No, absolutely he's doing that." So she's jumping the line like, "Well, I got to perform.
He
but,
wants
oh,
that
I gotta
fresh
go.
Canadian
I,
cooch.
I got to, you know, I got to do this thing. Oh, but I got to, you know, go over his house. I got
to
perform."
So she's talking to Melissa Joan Hart, who shows up again about her dilemma. And she should be like, "I don't fucking care because this is the third scene I'm in and you still owe me lasagna." But so she's like, "No, I guess I'll be your therapist because of the plot or whatever." So then is the fucking thing going on? The kids are at the club, right?
Yeah, we cut to the club, the third annual
hip-hop contest.
Everyone's there except for the old
anyone
starter.
Anyone in hip-hop.
Melissa Joan Hart is there.
Yeah, so she drove the kids here and the mom. I don't fucking know why she's there. Nobody knows why she's there.
No.
But she was literally just talking to the oldest daughter like, "Well, you got to follow your heart if you want to go to help your family or if you want to get draped by this scuzzbag."
So MC Hammer is like, "Hey, well, where's the oldest daughter?" And the middle one's like, "Oh, probably at Eric's house because he's a tool bag." And he's like, "Oh, man, I got to go get her." So he leaves.
MC Hammer goes to pick up the
MC
oldest
Hammer,
daughter.
Yeah.
But meanwhile, the kids are like, the person, it's like, "You got to sign up by 8:30. And the kids are, receptionist or whoever is like, "You have to have your entire crew here to sign up." And they're like, "Oh yeah, she's just throwing up in the bathroom. She throws up before every show. That's kind of her thing. Like, she's just bulimic. No big deal. Boop, boop, boop." And then MC Hammer buys time and goes to pick up Melissa Joan. No, fucking, who the fuck is she picking up?
The older daughter. Who's, you know, getting jumped.
She's getting dated.
By her boyfriend
who brings out, like, he's trying to seduce her with a six-pack of generic beer, which is like, there's a sticky note over the label, so you can't tell what it is.
And then onion dip, and he's like, "Why don't we get close to each other?" She's like, "Well, how about we watch the Pistons game?" "Yeah, why not?" She's like totally not into this, which is weird.
Yeah, she's not enjoying herself at all, yet she chooses a scenario.
She's going back and forth, but, you know,
which
like,
just
"Oh, I
got
to go over my boyfriend's.
She's got some deep issues.
I got to perform. I got to go to my boyfriend's. I got
to
perform." And while
she's
at her boyfriend's,
put herself
she's like, "Oh, this was the worst idea." Not thinking, "Well, I could just leave."
He's like, "Come on, let me rape you." And then she's like, "I'm going to go."
That word.
And then
So MC Hammer shows up as she's storming out of the house, and he consoles her, as he should, because she just went through a traumatic experience.
And the camera guy's there also, because you can clearly see his shadow throughout half the scene.
Yeah. So they make it back to the club, and we see a couple really good acts, including a dude who kind of looks like Sisko.
Well, I don't know about really good.
He's like a Seal Sisko.
Yeah, Seal Sisko. Oh, yeah, he does kind of look like Seal. Yeah, I could say if they had a baby, but he was still about 20.
Seal and Sisko had a baby?
Yeah. And then we age him about 25 years. I would say that's what one of the performers.
Yeah, so
there wasn't a whole lot of hip hop going. It was
mostly like
R&B.
Yeah. There is no hip hop at this hip hop contest.
Every song was like couple of words.
Yeah, everyone. Every song only has one line in it. Party here, party there, party up in the air. And then the other song was like bop it, punch it, bop it, poop poop, bop it, bop it, bop it. It was the commercial for Bop It.
Exactly. Yeah, they were just saying, they were covering that.
Yeah.
So it's time for the kids to go on, and the oldest daughter isn't there yet. So they drag Melissa Joan Hart up, and she's like, don't look at me. I'm not going to do this. But, you know, the youngest daughter's like, no, come on. And she gets her way.
Yeah, which, so she's like...
So the music starts, and
she says,
just
hit it!
In the nick of time, who shows up? But the oldest daughter just
with
starts
with the microphone
singing.
Already in her hand.
No, she grabbed it from the MC.
Well, the MC wouldn't have it turned on because he's clearly not on stage and he doesn't want to disrupt the...
This movie isn't real, dude.
You're going to start questioning this movie now.
I guess so, yeah.
This isn't real Detroit of all... I mean, come on.
The realism of sound mixers at clubs is none of my business.
So they perform, and they're all right.
No, they're terrible.
They're
the worst act there.
Sisko Seal was way better.
They're the worst act.
I enjoyed Sisko Seal.
Yeah, I did too. And, like, the boy...
Was he the guy in, like, the...
He was in the white, the bald head.
It was, like,
the white
mesh.
Scary.
That was, like, kind of... It's almost like a belly shirt.
His name was Tutti Frutti Fresh or something.
Something like that. Male stripper who repeating bop it, bop it, bop it.
No. He's the one who had the more R&B song, who had the tie bowing
dancers. There were the guy before... The guy after him was also... We have to just mention another R&B guy. He just had dicks for his hair. Right? He had, like, dreadlocks, but they were...
No, he had pointy spikes.
Dicks. They were dreadlock dicks coming out of
his
head.
They did not look very dick-like.
Dude, I've seen a lot of dicks
in my time. You're a sicko, dude.
Why am I a sicko? This guy's wearing dicks on his head. Not my fault.
He just got rape all night.
Dude, it's in the movie. It's in the movie. Did you watch it?
You're the one who didn't watch it.
Oh, my God. So, I just want to point that out. Guy's got crazy hair.
Yeah. So guess who wins? Not the kids.
Mm-mm. Sisko.
Sisko wins.
Not a
Sisko
happy ending
Seal.
Here.
No. So none of this needs to happen.
I did not see coming. I was.
That was a big twist of the movie.
Yeah. Which was great because they clearly showed the better act, and I I'm okay with that.
Yeah,
because
these kids fucking suck.
Well, there's a reason why no one likes them.
Because they're all white?
Because they all suck.
Oh, yeah, they suck. Yeah. But no, the audience loved it.
Yeah,
the audience was going nuts for this shitty, shitty song.
Listen, if this was the third annual mall, 80s mall pop concert, they would have won hands down. They were not close to R&B or hip hop.
Yeah, they're like
all.
A dance troupe. That you would see at the mall, right?
Exactly.
Yeah.
Exactly. They would be huge in the Mall of America.
It's like you're walking by. You're walking at the mall, and there's like 10-year-old girls dancing, and there's like a Katy Perry song, and you're like, "Gosh, shut the fuck up." That's.
But
what
you know,
this is
they
like.
Tried their hardest, so they're not terribly disappointed. The mom can still get another job. They're still going to be fine. They were just kind of doing this to prove they can do it. Which apparently they can.
Yeah, they can.
Just, you know, not in this atmosphere.
So they lose, and then...
Another b-ball scene with the producer and MC Hammer, and they're both wearing sweet tracksuits.
Oh, yeah. And their MC Hammer's like, I failed. They didn't win the contest. I guess I can't be a producer. And then his manager is like, you've been a producer all along. I believe in you, man. And then
you took those shitty three kids and added that girl with the great voice, and you made it really good. And that's why you can be a producer.
Yeah.
That's what being a producer is about. You take a shitty act.
You polish
it up.
And so then he gets the job as the producer, and then he goes to the kid's house, right?
Yeah.
And
it's the exact same scene from the beginning after making the breakfast where the mom's like, oh, I'm running late for being a real estate agent again.
She's got a new job, and the new job just means that she goes from a red blazer to a blue blazer. It's right. the exact same outfit.
And she says the exact same thing, like, oh, littlest girl, don't stay in your PJs all day.
Yeah.
You, boy, brush your teeth. You do your homework. Oh, I got to get out of here. Oh, who's at the door? MC Hammer. And he gives him a check for $5,000.
What? That's the exact amount that they need.
Exactly, because he's a big shot producer now in the span of a day.
And he made $5,000. Like, is that his signing bonus?
He probably got, you know, an advance or something. But then he says something that
I think he still has no money himself and
he's broke as fuck. He's working on it. You know, he has a job now. He's moving
because he's
up
got
in the
a
world.
Sweet leopard skin shirt.
Yeah. Exactly.
So you know he's made it in the big time.
He's looking good.
Yeah, it looks like he's at the door and he's like, we're going to put your mom to work.
He and Speedboat would be fantastic pals because they have the best wardrobes.
Yes. Oh, yeah, definitely.
Yeah.
The only thing MC Hammer didn't have was a fanny pack.
That's true. That's very true.
He'll get there.
He almost got the puffy jacket.
But then...
Oh, yeah.
So he had... MC Hammer has this great line where he's like, oh, well, I'm all set because I'm living paycheck to paycheck now.
Like, that's not all like, set.
That's
not a good thing.
That's
you don't
like
wanna,
college me.
Yeah, you don't want to brag about
that. Well, kinda, I still live paycheck
to paycheck. I was
kind
of thinking he was eventually going to be able to, like, sign the oldest daughter, but that never happened.
Right.
So he doesn't even sign these kids.
They figure out a solution because MC Hammer has this big empty house. And
that I guess he doesn't have a mortgage on.
No, because he probably hit it big and he bought the house outright.
But he didn't buy his couch outright? That doesn't make any fucking sense.
Well, I mean, he's got to pay for, you know, keep the lights on.
His couch gets repossessed.
He sold his couch.
His house doesn't...
He sold his couch to
pay the light bill?
Because remember, at one point he's like, oh, well, how much will I get for a gold record? $40.
Yeah.
This is for the hit, blah, blah, blah. $45, blah, blah, blah.
For Party in the Air.
So they...
They move into his house.
Yeah, there's some sort of dialogue exchange that I could not make out.
There's like two sentences. They're like, blah, 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 blah. Let's move into your house. Blah, 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 blah. Okay.
We have stuff. We have a lot of people.
You have a place to put
our stuff. You have a big house. We're all friends here. Let's move in together.
Yeah, they're like, you need a roommate. And he's like, no, I need to fuck bitches and do cocaine because I am a record producer. I don't need five white people holding me down. Like, what if he wants to bring home some house?
Nope. Wrong. They all move in together.
And
this, you know, it's the one thing, the unhappy ending for Jumpin' Flash, Kid Macadada, he never gets his Bentley back by at the end of the movie.
Yeah, he never got his Bentley back. Right? He loses out.
Sad ending for him.
I'd like to believe that at some point he gets it back.
Oh, yeah?
At some point he gets it
back.
That's the sequel.
That's a road trip movie. The more right connections.
The even righter connections.
Yeah.
So, that's the end of the movie. The credits roll. And
they're like 30 seconds
best
long.
Part of the movie
because there's like 10 people
after
that worked
the credits,
on this movie.
When there's no movie, it's black video for like
they
3
play
minutes
his hit
of
song.
Just his song.
Yeah, and so the song that they play is longer than the credits because the credits are like 30 seconds long and the song is like 3 minutes and it just keeps playing over
they
black
don't
screen.
Fade it out or anything. It just
because
keeps
they're
going.
Like, oh, we paid for MC Hammer to sing this song, so we're gonna fucking use it.
And the whole time he's just,
yeah, he's just talking. Yeah.
Yeah. That's my favorite part of the movie.
That's the movie.
Thing. That is the right connection.
Everything works out. So.
The right connections. Yes.
Trying to look up some facts about this movie.
Good luck.
There is no Wikipedia page for this movie.
What did it get on IMDb?
Is there an IMDb?
There is, but it doesn't have any trivia.
It's like, be the first to...
So the only thing they had on it besides, you know, the production crew and the cast and all that, done in 1997, we stated before, 97 minutes, something like that.
Yep.
Although IMDb said 2 hours, but maybe that's like with the
that's
song
the
at the end.
That's the director's cut. That's sure. like the Ridley Scott version.
Yeah, exactly. So this movie won, or Yeah, this movie won two awards.
Oh, the Raspberry?
From the Young Artist Awards.
Did it get a Nickelodeon Teachers Award?
No Nickelodeon Award. It won Best Family TV Movie / Pilot / Miniseries.
Pilot?
To one of the Hart kids.
Yeah, who knows?
And then Best Performance in a TV Show or Miniseries. It won two awards.
This isn't a TV show or a miniseries.
No. It's not, but it won, okay. So whatever.
So I looked up two of the ratings because I went, you know, you can find the VHS and you can find the DVD
on Amazon. Kevbot put a lot more work into this than either of us.
Yeah, you know, I was getting into it. I had the right connections to this movie. So, all right, I'm gonna have you guys guess the Amazon rating and the IMDb rating.
I know the IMDb one is 4.2.
Okay.
Wow, that's pretty high.
That is very high.
Out of 10?
Out of 10.
Or out of 5.
Out of 10, dude.
Okay, so then you guys got to guess the Amazon one, which is out of 5.
Out of 5?
You guess, Dane.
Like a 1.5.
Topher?
I'm going to have to say 1.5.
Had 3 ratings, 5 stars.
No way! Are they all from the Hart children?
All... 3 ratings, all 5 stars.
Holy
shit. That's awesome.
They love this movie.
Oh,
and IMDb only gave it a 4.3.
Did they write anything?
They did, but I didn't have enough time to read it.
Was it like, dad was in this?
One was in all caps. I know that. Someone was really so excited about this.
I gotta look these up
tomorrow. God,
that's
dangerous.
Crazy.
Yeah.
Wow.
So, all right.
Shows you how useful those reviews are.
What would you
guys rate this movie? We'll say out of 10.
Out of 10?
Oh, my God.
Damn. Oh, man. I think... I don't know. IMDb is pretty accurate at 4.2. It's a fun movie. I give it a 6.
Would you rewind it and watch it again?
I did rewind it. This is the second time I watched it.
I forgot.
So, yeah, it's a fun, ridiculous movie. I recommend it. It's not, like, a good movie, but definitely watch it if you find it somewhere. But don't buy it.
Yeah.
Unless it's 99 cents.
What about you, dude?
Well, what about you, Dane Train? What do you think?
I asked you first.
Oh, okay. I would give this an 8 out of 10.
The moderator. He doesn't want to answer.
8 out of 10. You see... You
8
see,
out of 10.
8
fuck.
Out of 10. You wow. see MC Hammer grow as a person. You see some great
Holy
acts.
Shit.
You hear Dane fart a lot.
I'm not cutting that out.
We had Burger King. Well, I'm telling you, just like I mentioned last time, whenever you watch these movies, you need two things. It's essential. A, your best friends, and B, some real bad food.
Some junk food.
I had chicken fries.
It's
so.
A great...
We heard.
This is not an endorsement for Burger King, by the way.
Just like this movie. It's a real stinker.
Oh, man. I disagree.
So
8 out of 10.
8 out of 10.
You get some sweet performances.
Do you?
Well, you get to see the fresh wardrobe of MC Hammer.
Oh, yeah.
You get Cisco Seal.
It takes it back to the 90s.
You get fake blood.
It is very 90s, yeah.
Yeah. I enjoyed it a lot. I enjoyed it a lot.
I consider this the hip-hop movie of the 90s.
It's like if you liked 8 Mile, you'll love The Right Connections.
For any of you guys listening to this, we picked up on something in a lot of movies in the 80s and 90s where in almost every movie, not in this one, unfortunately, I thought we would have caught it, but nobody said it, where they say, this is something for the 90s or of the 90s. So, like if you ever watch Hard Bodies, the guy goes, oh, this is the body of the 80s. Or
come on, it's the 90s, it's, you know, Mom.
You know, like in Adventures of Ford Fairlane, Tone Loc is like, yo, man, this is the song of the 90s.
Yeah.
You know, so like there's all these movies from back then where
you would
people
think
would,
they
say,
would say it.
Of the 90s or whatever. So I was expecting MC Hammer to say it, but man, whatever.
This is the new group of the 90s.
Yeah.
So what would you recommend this or what? What would your rating be?
I think everybody on
10.
The planet should watch this movie.
10 out
At
of
least
10.
Once. I give this movie a 9.5 out of 10.
Holy fuck.
But I would not rewind it. I watched
what
it.
What does
I
that
thought
mean?
It was great.
Watch it. It's a 9 out of... It's the,
it's a great movie to watch once.
It's a Citizen Kane of hip-hop movies, but I'd watch it once.
It's something that everyone needs to experience in their life once. It's a big life-changing event.
It's a hip-hop movie of the 90s once.
So, guys, you can find this movie on YouTube.
The whole shebang?
Full movie. Really? All 1 hour, 37 minutes. Not 2 hours.
This movie's way too long.
Wow.
You can also, I'm sure, find it on... Yeah, buy it on... You can get it on Amazon.
You can buy it from me if you want.
I'll buy it from you.
98.
I'll buy you Burger King next time.
This is a wicked fun movie.
It is really fun.
It's great. Fun for the whole family of the 90s.
Even if you don't have a dad.
Oh, yeah.
Which they don't. Wow, I don't know if they said that enough.
Or if you live in Detroit. Or if you live in Vancouver, Detroit. Anywho. Well,
so that's it for this episode.
Yeah, that wraps up our second episode. Thanks for listening. As always, I'm KevBot.
I'm Topher Hansen.
This is Dane Train. And we have a Facebook page. Facebook.com/VHS Bandits. You want to find us out on the email?
We are VHSBandits@gmail.com.
Do we have Twitter and all
we
that
do.
Stuff?
We have at thevhbandits.com, not VHS Bandits. Or
no. Twitter handle is at V. Fuck. The Twitter handle is at thevhsbandits. And the email.
Why did I say .com?
I don't know.
Stupid.
And VH band. It's no S.
Oh man.
Email us suggestions on Facebook or whatever. You can email us at thevhsbandits@gmail.com.
Guys, you can also find us on Tumblr.
Really?
At vhsbandits.tumblr.com.
Cool.
We're trying to spread the love everywhere.
And just so you guys can stay in sheer anticipation, we have picked out our third movie tonight. It looks like the most bitchin' thing on the planet. None of us had ever heard about it. KevBot got it from the store that he works at, and I am dying to see this sucker. So, stay in anticipation. You'll find all about that next time we do this. So
thanks again for listening. And as always, be kind. Rewind. Let's hit the eject button. Let's hit the eject button. Let's hit the eject button. Let's hit the eject button.